We're on? Okay. Okay, everybody. Let's keep her down. So we're here. We're here with Mr. Jerome Hill, scratching his chin in nervous fashion.
Yep.
He has flown over for his Canadian debut tomorrow at Suba here in Hamilton, and we're gonna start off with a bit of a chat. I'm gonna review some of his personal history in the music scene.
Okay.
We're gonna do that for as long as possible, so we really drag this out. And then he's going to play some tunes for 15, 20 minutes, show off some of his magic wrist skills, and then we'll open it up to a question and answer thing for all of you here in attendance. So to get started, Jerome.
Hello.
So you've been playing for quite a while now.
Yeah, probably since, 30 years now, this year, in fact.
30 years exactly. You have an anniversary that you celebrate?
I don't celebrate it, no.
As it shouldn't be. So when you first got started, what kind of stuff were you playing? You haven't been playing, techno, which is what you're known for mostly now in its various shades.
Well, when I first started, it was a kind of mixture of techno, like as in 1990 Belgium, R&S, American stuff as well. A mixture of techno, house, breakbeat, like pre-hardcore stuff, hip-hop as well, just a big old melting pot of anything goes, really, whatever was playing on the pirate radios back then.
So the pirate radios, that's something that we don't really have any experience with over here in Canada, North America. What is that scene like? How much influence would you say it has?
Well, back then it was everything. It was between pirate radio and record shops. That was the equivalent of what the internet is now. That was that's where you hear the music, where you find out the names of things, where you find out about the parties, where they are. Where you just can like monitor the development of the music, really.
And so for the pirate radio stations, how much range would they have had? Like the way we understand it over here, if it's a truly pirate radio station and it's an illegal broadcast, is it the same over there?
Yeah.
Right,
yeah.
So we would imagine that it wouldn't have significant range. Is it like a 2 kilometer bubble around wherever the broadcast is going from?
No, well, it depends. It would depend on the size of their transmitter. It would depend on, the equipment they had. And the skyline around wherever the transmitter was.
So would it be portable so as they wouldn't be discovered?
I think I've heard stories about people driving around with it in the boot of their car and just driving around London with it. But I think for the main part, they were, on tower block roofs, up trees sometimes, in elevator shafts. That kind of thing,
So all the places we all hang out already.
Yeah, all the places you wouldn't go unless you absolutely had to, yeah.
Fair enough. Yeah. So when you got started, you're playing, the essentially the same sort of stuff you're playing now, just 30 years older, right? Because you're still playing a very healthy variety of, a similar assortment, house, techno, hardcore, breaks.
Yeah, I guess
acid,
so, yeah.
All of that. So yeah. It's really just a maturation. You've never kind of flipped and, just changed the plot completely.
No. I've kind of concentrated on one area more than others at times, but no, it always kind of, like a pinball machine, bounces off those sort of, the hardcore breaks kind of stuff, old school breakbeat, techno, hip-hop, acid, within the realm, yeah.
All the good stuff.
And also, as that old bleep show I did for you once, or the kind of
the mad, German swing?
Yeah, the German swing, and other sort of kind of non-classifiable real music, I call it, with instruments and stuff, yeah.
Fun stuff.
Fun
but
stuff,
it's still good.
Yeah.
So aside from the pirate radio stations, I believe the sound system culture in the UK is also something that we don't have here. there's been some sharing of the free party kind of ethos over here.
Yeah.
It never really developed as well as it did on your side, though.
Was that, why was that, do you think? Is that down to the authorities or down to the lack of...
I don't think it's authorities. I mean, there's going to be a contributing factor for sure. I think a lot of it is the way that people here ingest the music seems to be a lot different than on your side. So whenever I'm on your side, one of the things that strikes me is that the people who are there having a really good time tend to be closer to my own age, and they've been listening to that music, this music, for a very long time. There's a lot more history. Over here, it seems people grow out of it. And I'm the one that apparently has not, me and Corey. Yeah. So over here, more often than not, people tend to grow out of it. I mean, we all grow up. We all have, you know, wives, kids.
Yeah.
You know, jobs that we have to do.
Yeah.
But a lot of people just seem to move away from it, whereas over there, it seems to be more of a lifelong passion, which I can certainly appreciate.
I mean, I think people move away from it over there as well. There's more historical kind of tradition of it, though, over in the UK. Whereas, you know, it's a kind of accepted part of, you know, it's a valid
expression.
Yeah,
yeah,
for want of a better word. Yeah, a valid sort of musical scene that. The older it gets, the more people who were there back then are now kind of, or even weren't there back then, you know, who are getting, they've grown up with it, and now they're in positions of, you know, they might be film directors or TV commissioners or whatever, and they have an interest in it, so they put it out there, and then the young people, kind of, it's there already and everyone knows about it.
So there has been a spate of books released lately.
There has, yeah, yeah.
There's been three or four that I'm aware of just in the last couple months.
I bought the Bleep one, yeah.
I haven't read any of them. It's been a while since I bought a new book, but I'm well overdue. I'll probably start with Mr. Joe Muggs when it's out.
Oh, yeah, yeah, Joe's one. Bass, mids, and tops.
Yep. So now that question originally started as one of sound system culture.
Oh, yeah.
Would you want to give a rundown on what that was and what it maybe is now?
Well, I mean, you know, I can't speak really for the reggae sound system culture because I wasn't...
Well, you were part of the Jibba sound system, right?
I was part of a sound system called Jibba.
So from personal experience then,
yeah.
What was your personal experience?
Personal experience was... week in, week out, getting in the van, sound system in the back, going to squat buildings, cinemas, post offices, bingo halls, anything. There was kind of certain people that looked after the breaking of the buildings. And then every weekend, you know, often people would squat them and live in them, and even maybe clean them up and do them up during the week or over a few weeks, and then there'd be a flyer and a party, and that kind of, yeah, it was just relentless. It was every weekend. There was, I guess, you know, a good few London sound systems doing the same who would combine. There was a phone line called United Systems where everyone, when you had your address, you'd give it to them and they'd put it on the phone line. So all the ravers would phone up and they'd get a choice of, like, you know, there's Aardvark and Immersion in Wood Green at this address. There's Jibber and Virus in South London at this address. There's, you know, everyone would have somewhere to go.
So right away, I see a difference there. In Toronto in the 90s, there was... of course, an info line to call to find out where the events were, because the details were never published in advance.
Yeah.
You could call the day of the event to find out where it was.
That's it.
But every single promotional company And that's all it ever was here. It was always a promotional company. It wasn't a traveling sound system of any sort. So there's a different way that it was thought about here. But they all had their own info line. So there was never a massive sharing of resources in that respect.
I think people had their own info line as well. But United Systems ran from about maybe 93 until 97 maybe or 8 even.
And that was chunk of time.
when they stopped doing that, there wasn't really that. You didn't have that anymore.
So it did was, they stop doing that, and that led to sound systems not being as rampant? Or do you think sound systems rampancy slowed down and then United backed off of it because it wasn't filling as much of a role as they maybe were previously?
I don't know, to be honest. I'm not sure.
It'll have to be one of those unanswered questions.
Yeah, I couldn't comment on that, really. I don't know why they stopped, but, you know, it still goes on. It's still there today, though, different sound systems, but the same kind of premise. Not quite as many sound systems and not quite as many parties and more hassle from the police, definitely. But, yeah, it's still a weekly thing.
So between listening to pirate radio, participating in and going to sound system events, I know you also worked at a few record shops.
Yep.
There used to be many years ago. I don't know if it's been edited, but there used to be a Wikipedia article that gives you credit for naming the genre of techno as wonky.
Yeah, I remember that.
I don't know if that's still online, but Wikipedia at one time had that.
Someone took it off. No, it's not there anymore.
Probably no source, right?
Maybe, yeah, I guess so. Yeah.
Would you like to repeat that to further cement it?
Get my pound of flesh. Yeah, no, it was just in the record shop. I just had a section called Wonky Techno, which was a word I thought described quite well the productions of Christian Vogel, Cybeg, Subhead, Landstrom, that kind of end of things. And yeah, it kind of, people started referring to it as that, I guess. Not everyone, just, you know.
A few.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, only a few.
I think all the people who were referred to as that didn't really appreciate being referred to as that, really.
It probably felt as if it was being pigeonholed or...
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think as soon as people realised there was a sound there, then lots of people kind of, you know, the usual, jumped on it and emulated it and ultimately killed it a little bit, maybe.
Yeah, it certainly has morphed over the years, as any genre should. I liken it in a way to Detroit techno. So Detroit techno, when it first, you know, arose, there really was none, right? A lot of it was just via context. There was, you know, a small handful of records from, you know, the original three in Detroit, and they were playing those, but they were mixing it with a lot of other things, disco, house, you know, hip hop, you know, maybe sped up. So there was the Detroit genre was a lot of the times via context of what it was played with. Right?
Yeah.
And then when people started intentionally making Detroit techno
records,
it started almost finding like a mean average, right? You have this big starting point, and then more and more people focus on the genre, and it becomes this singular thing, which kind of kills it.
That's what about certain genres that come out of dance music. I really believe they shouldn't have been genres, that someone made a really amazing track, really forward-thinking tune, and someone called it, oh, that's whatever, something step, and then a million people make a tune with the same beat or the same structure, and it becomes a genre, but, yeah. And I was always confused with Detroit techno, because Detroit techno to me means both kind of very soulful, you know, soaring kind of beautiful chords and pads and the undercarriage as well. But then it Jeff Mills. Was you go and see Jeff Mills in, as I did in 90, maybe 3 or 4 at a club in London. And it was, to my ears then, it was so hard and so, it was like GABA. It was really hardcore. And for that to be Detroit techno and for Strings of Life or something to be Detroit techno, they're kind of polar opposites, really. And it, I think with all genres, it depends on, you know, who's saying it. Everyone means something different by any genre, I think, you know.
Oh, yeah, genres. I mean, aside from, you know, what, Beatport or whatever record store you're buying stuff from, they're going to have their categories. But, I mean, there's going to be a ton of people that, you know, obviously disagree with that for many reasons. I mean, I think just today I saw Beatport has reclassified techno into,
yeah, I saw
two,
that.
Into
yeah.
two. You know, you got your raw and your deep and your peak time drivers.
Oh, it's awful. Yeah.
Awful, yes. It's agreed. I don't know if I can clearly elucidate exactly why in my mind it's awful yet. I mean, when I go record shopping, right, well, which is usually online nowadays because there's no shops nearby that have anything I like, it's, you know, I'll start with the techno section, but I go through pretty much every section except for maybe trance and drum and bass, right? Because there's always things that have been, they don't think it's been misclassified, but I will think it's been misclassified. When you're shopping for records, tunes, what's your overall approach? Do you just kind of go wide? Do you start with one genre and then slowly expand out amongst the categories?
I guess I look in, you know, online shopping these days. I'd look in the techno section. I look in the hip-hop section. I look in all of them, really. Well, no, that's a lie, not all of them. I look in those two, mainly.
That's basically all of them.
Yeah, well, what else do I... I'm sure I... Yeah, I think they're the ones I look for online. And then there's Discogs, which is most of my record buying, which you don't do by sections, you do by...
You have to have something in mind, usually, to look for.
Yeah, or you do, like, you surf, you go on and you look at an artist, and you look at all their records, and then you look at the labels, and then you listen to stuff and just navigate that way. And that could be, you could start off in any genre, really, with that.
So your record collection at home, I know you've been recording a lot of it and selling off in batches and whatnot. How many records would you say you still have sitting around at home, cluttering up your hallways and preventing you from having a dog because there's no room?
I don't know. Definitely a lot less than I used to have. I'd say probably, well, because I buy and sell records as well, so a lot of them are for, you know, I've got a room which is my sort of stock room, but of my personal ones, maybe 5,000-ish, possibly, maybe less, maybe 4,000.
You just don't go any lower than that, or you've lost all of our respect.
Yeah. Maybe 3,900.
You're making it hard. All right, man. Anything you want to add before you play a couple tunes?
No, just thanks for bringing me out to Canada, Hamilton even. And yeah, looking forward to tomorrow.
All right. Yeah. All right, let's play some music.
What's happening tomorrow?
I'm playing with Trev at...
In my bedroom.
I can't even say the name. Subas.
Suba.
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 Like fubar.
En okay. Français.
Okay, all right, yeah. Yeah.
All right.
Let's do this.
Let's do it.
Yeah. We'll be right back. bass.
All right, everybody. Does anybody have any questions they would like to ask of Mr. Jerome?
Okay, perfect. So as far as production goes, how long do you spend on a given track, or is it kind of just how you're feeling the vibe? And
yeah, it's all, it could be like I did, well, I did, I've, you know, you can do one, it depends what mood you're in, really.
Yeah.
It can be really quick. More often it's, you know, over weeks, kind of wait, you've got to wait for the time and the inspiration to kind of come at the same time. Mm. Sometimes you have the inspiration and you don't have the time.
Yeah.
And sometimes you have the time and you sit there dry humping this arrangement and just nothing.
It's getting worse.
Yeah, it just gets worse and worse. And then the day's gone. Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah. Yeah. It can go either way, really, yeah. I guess.
And then follow up with that is, for yourself, when do you know when a track's done? That's a tough one, man. That's
yeah,
a tough
I
one.
Mean, it's. I guess it's not that it's done, it's that you need to just commit to it and move on for your own sanity. And it's usually the first mix that's the best one. Like, yeah, yeah.
That's all I had.
I thought, yeah.
Yeah. Regardless of genre of music that you may be producing or spinning, is there a BPM that you just locks you in, that you just kind of get the groove for? Is it, you know, you're kind of all over the place? Or is there like a certain, you know what I mean? Like BPM that like,
yeah,
you're really comfortable with? You kind of like just...
For hip-hop, I like 110. I like 110, I like 100. I'm mainly on the 10s because I... You know,
no halves?
Because no. I think my OCD can't deal with just random. Yeah, I've got to get it to a, you know, maybe an 8 or a 6 as well, or a 5. 5's all right. It's halfway. For techno, I think I usually go about 130, sometimes 135, but then I like 125. I like lots of them. Yeah.
So there's nothing like in particular. It's kind of just.
No,
getting the groove in a certain session or you know, a DJ.
Yeah, I'm into like musically and in life. I think peaks and troughs. So, you know, if one day you're down there, then the next day you're doing something up the other end, and you can kind of get the enjoyment out of each. Really,
cool.
I think something like that.
Perfect. Now, I'll just jump to about gear. Do you have a preference? Not a brand drop or anything, but like, do you cheap gear, industry standard gear, use it all, get familiar with it, be versatile, you know, whatever.
Are we talking DJ stuff?
Yeah.
I mean, I do like a Pioneer mixer, just because I went for ages, all the clubs would have them, so I kind of got used to doing that. It means you can be a little bit lazy sometimes with mixing things out. You can kind of echo things out, and you know, but yeah, you know, Technics, Dex, Pioneer CDJs as well, just standard stuff, I think.
Do you think someone using an inexpensive controller is going to hit a wall trying to scratch?
I I don't know, because I'm not sure of the... I imagine, possibly, because... Well, it depends on your style of scratching as well, really, because if you never let the platter go, then as long as the latency is all right, you don't need to... I find with digital scratching, once you let it go, it's tricky to get it back sometimes to the exact right... Or it's tricky to make it behave like a record would. But you can do loads of stuff without letting it go and kind of keep your hand on it and things.
You're a big fan of the physical feedback, the mechanical, the response you get. You feel it, you connect.
Well, I suppose so. I mean, that's what I've grown up with. So I guess, yeah. You work with what you're comfortable with or what you're used to, and practice makes... Not perfect, but practice makes it better. So whatever you use, I believe limitations are good. So whatever you use, you can just push against your limits, and you probably come out with some interesting stuff that no one else has, because you've got to like do some arse about tit way to do something, and that can splinter off into something else, kind of.
I have another question.
Yes.
Do you remember what song was the song that really turned you on to this kind of music?
As in electronic music or dance
electronic,
music?
Electronic, like techno, house, like any DJ music.
There were a few. The very first one was West Street Mob, Electric Boogie, Breakdance Electric Boogie, which is the Apache break, basically just Apache.
You should remix that sometime.
Have I done it? I don't know. Oh, that was another track from the same album. Yeah. Yeah, and then Phantom, Renegade Soundwave, Phantom 1990. Basically everything I heard in 1990 was Meat Beat Manifesto, Radio Babylon, Helter Skelter, Shut Up and Dance, Big Daddy Kane, Public Enemy, like loads of stuff. Nice. Stuff. I used to always like stuff with really annoying, like in Public Enemy, they used to have these really annoying, screechy kind of noises in it. Mm. So I think that started my annoying noises kind of thing.
So does Trevor.
Yeah. Well, that's, yeah. Maybe why we clicked.
So in terms of being a DJ, do you think it's more important to play to the crowd and what they want to hear, or maybe the vibe that you're trying to create and bring to the party yourself? I hear that argument a lot and debate a lot within the community. Yeah, so what do you think is more important?
There's two sides to it, isn't it? It's, educate them or give them what they want.
The track that they didn't know they wanted to hear, right?
Exactly. Yeah, that's the quote, isn't it? Give them what they didn't yet realize they want to hear. I think both. I think I'd never play anything that I didn't love. I wouldn't have anything with me that I didn't love anyway. Yeah. So, but within that, I'm always trying to get to my thing, and then so you can. It's all about introducing music in a certain way, like presenting it, maybe even tricking people into kind of suddenly there's something quite odd on or just a bit, and they're like, oh, why are we dancing to this? It's like, it's just smoke and mirrors, like, but yeah, definitely trying to play good and challenging stuff, which I don't always do. I it's about trying to keep the dance floor going, but slipping them some,
kind of a fine line of the both, right?
Balancing getting the both, yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And then second to that, to do with DJing, how do you organize your music for sets? So are you like, I know these tracks I'd want to play kind of in the beginning, they're a little bit slower, and then increase the energy? Or how do you go about programming a set or your music that you're going to play during a set?
I literally, as I said before, I don't.
Just on the go.
I mean, I might, it was a lot, when it was vinyl only, it was great because you could turn up and then 10, 15 minutes before you set, you can judge by what's going on and just have a look through, maybe decide on your first record, then the DJ will suddenly change it all up to decide on another one. But now a lot of it, I bring kind of, you know, I bring records, but a lot of what I have is on USB. And I was saying to someone, that's what they need to invent, a little handheld USB thingy that you can like look
change
at.
Change the songs.
And just, or just see what you've got on it. Because when you're trying to think of it, you can't. But yeah, I'd maybe have my first record in mind.
Gotcha.
And maybe like a fence, you have some posts, like mm-hmm. I definitely want to play them this one, and I've just got this one, so I want to play that.
Fill in the gaps.
And then you kind of, yeah, exactly, okay. Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
I really
something like
that.
Thank
you.
Yeah, wing it.
So for production-wise, like when you're starting a track, do you have any sort of like goal in mind, like genre, style, feeling, anything? Or do you just kind of like choose a sample and kind of go off it?
On a good day, it will be because I've heard something and I'll have something will pop into my mind that, oh, that would be good, you know, chopped up and cut up. And so, yeah, on a bad day, then it will just be like, oh, I need to make this. I haven't done anything for ages. And you'll go there. And I find it's quite good to not put a kick drum in it for as long as you can. Because I used to always start with a kick. Boom, boom, boom. And then everything kind of builds on that almost. And it can end up a bit, or I realized afterwards that if I don't do that, then you've got to think more about the rhythm and textures and like the mix. And then once you add the kick in, there's like, there's stuff going on, you know? Whereas
yeah,
if you start with
usually, if I like put a whole bunch of samples and had something going, if I would do like a temporary drum track with like the standard samples, after a bit I'd be like, something's not sounding right, and like, oh no, I'm mixing these standard samples. And like,
what I used to do as well is like if I wanted to make if there was a tune I really liked that was inspiring me, I'd sample it, like sample a whole loop of it, put it in, like. I always liken it to like if you're growing a little sapling tree, you stick your big post in the ground and then you tie the sapling round. So you grow the sapling against the big tree. So you have your sample, then you kind of add stuff in over the top, underneath, put a baseline on it, and then you take that sample away and chuck it, and you've got something which has the still carries over from that kind of thing.
It's not quite what
but you haven't ripped off, you know.
Yeah.
There's not a huge chunk of someone else's tune in there. Yeah. Like,
I've tried that before, but usually without like taking a piece of it and just like trying to recreate it, and it ends up with something totally different anyway. So
I mean, I think with production, that's, you'll never get, well, maybe in the future you'll be able to link up your brain, but until then you'll always be being sidetracked and you'll end up with something different from what you're going for. Yeah. But that's how you make different stuff, and I don't think anyone totally gets there, you know. And that's the process.
Yeah, I know, right? No, thanks first and foremost. Thank you for coming out, Jerome.
No, thanks for having me.
Yeah, no, it's awesome. It's been
a fun time. What an amazing place it is as well. Amazing. Yeah.
We've been plugging away at it for a couple of years, but it's getting there, but we enjoy it, right? First and foremost, thank you so much for coming out and hanging out with us and chilling out and all that good stuff, right? We appreciate having you here. Can't wait to see you tomorrow night, that's for sure.
I'm looking forward.
At Suba. Suba.
Suba. Yeah.
Suzbaz. Yeah, yeah. No, I just had a question about mainly about production.
Okay.
Sample selection. Now, I know a lot of like younger fellows and stuff, they go to like websites like Splice and get like loops and one shots and things like that.
Yeah.
How do you find your samples for productions?
I mean, I don't use sample packs.
Yeah.
Although I use some drum machine single hit kind of things.
Yeah.
Sample wise, I'm very, I don't know, like I'll be watching a film and someone will say something.
Yeah.
If you're watching it with someone, maybe make a note of the minute.
Yeah, exactly.
Or listen to the radio, you know. Or
just get those little quotes in the songs and things like that.
I was watching the new Quentin Tarantino one on the plane on the way over, and there's a scene where Brad Pitt's in the, like, Tarantino always has pretty, like, gutsy soundtracks.
Yeah.
And the Brad Pitt gets in this car and drives off and turns up the radio, and there's this tune on there,
yeah,
which I've noted down, and it's gonna, I'm gonna use it as soon as I find out what it is.
So an all exclusive right there, cover Studio 14 drone.
I like lots of spoken word. I like using lots of words. Yeah. Like,
I've heard of guys digging into like 80s sci-fi movies and stuff like that to try to find quotes and things.
Yeah,
I don't know if that card's overplayed now, but it's...
I just don't know, I like anything. Yeah. I think you should be able to use anything because it is so, saturated with just sample pack kind of culture, and that's why everyone sounds
Similar. Yeah. And I've seen a lot of that, taking loops and layering loops and stuff like that. And it's, I do respect it, but I feel it's more composition, right?
Yeah.
So instead of producing,
And the important thing is you can make anything work. Like, if you believe it's going to work and if you've got the idea, you can make it work on your own terms.
Well, I heard he mentioned something about my in-key question.
Your what?
My in-key question.
Oh, right.
Like, when you're taking samples, putting them in productions, do you worry about the key?
No. I mean, I don't know what any key is in.
Yeah.
Like... if it clashes,
you can tell. Well, as a DJ, you can just tell.
You can move the string up until it sounds good.
Yeah.
How
do you feel about pitch shifting and warping in Ableton with samples? Do you feel like you can pitch shift it and not have a loss of quality?
Can you give an example of
like, for instance, say like you want to pitch your snare drum sample and you pitch it up, like the speed of that snare drum is going to, it's going to shrink a bit and speed up and everything like that. Do you ever do any adjustments to time stretch those samples, or do you just pitch them up and then place them in the track when they sound good enough?
Yeah, I mean...
Do you worry about too much about editing?
To be honest, I know that's just an example. I don't really pitch up kind of little, percussion stuff.
Sounds good.
But yeah, with a, if I've got like a texture, which I want a bit higher, then... on Ableton anyway, you can put it onto, take it off beats for starters.
Like, go to Complex and Complex Pro whatnot, right? But no, I'm just curious about that and sample selection and stuff, right? Just so, like Trevor's also telling me you made a snare out of something interesting.
Yeah.
Recently.
The crisp, flicking a crisp packet. I've got a Zoom H4N recorder.
Yeah.
And I went for... I stayed in this kind of like a farm in Munich.
Yeah.
And I took it with me and I just recorded loads and loads of just not like leaves and cat people like crunching carrots and stuff. And I actually made a whole track out of all that stuff using
that's awesome.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah. And it really opened my head up actually. Yeah. It's like, make your own things. And it made me realize there's rhythm kind of anywhere, everything. You drop a set of keys on a table, mic'd up, that's going to sound absolutely incredible.
Could sound cool with like an open hi-hat.
As a snare on the two and four, that's going to be really, and just anything. Like,
that's the ultimate creativity at the end of the day. You're making your own samples now and putting them in your tracks.
Do all that stuff. you had that sample, didn't you? Yeah, exactly that. Yeah. Pitch that up.
A couple shots, No, I'm just curious about that because I've seen a lot of young producers and like really at the end of the day, the only thing you have to rely on is like YouTube videos to get into production and get into Ableton and stuff like that. So as like a seasoned vet, I figure I'd ask you about it.
I'm still learning like the production. I'm getting a bit better. I got new monitors and they made a lot of difference actually.
Do you mind sharing what monitors you have?
They're the KRK, but they're V6, I think.
Oh, the 6? Yeah, the 6-inch little sub on the bottom. The 6-inch sub, I think it is.
Possibly.
I don't know. I have KRKs as well, so I love
them. I don't really look at them.
But they sound damn good. That's
They sound really good.
But I don't want to continue to harass you and bug you with questions. I appreciate everything, Jerome.
Thank you. Thanks a lot for it.
Hopefully you enjoyed our little space.
It's lovely, yeah.
Don't be a stranger,
really
you know.
Maybe. It's a proper club, like a private club, a members club.
Yeah, it's a members only club, a gentleman's club, I guess. Eh? Right? But no, I appreciate you coming down.
No, thank you. Thanks for having me.
Trevor's told me a lot about you and stuff like that, so it's very nice to finally meet you.
No, cheers, man. Thanks.
Yeah, good luck tomorrow night.
Hey, thanks. Cheers.
Okay. Anyone else? Thanks for stopping by, Jerome.
No, thanks for having me. And I feel like a total imposter up here talking about production and stuff, but thank you.
Much obliged, and thank you for coming down.
Thanks, man. Thank you.
All right.
Cheers.
Yeah.
Nice. Excellent. It does feel nice, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Interesting. I did a helium enema earlier.
And I may be suffering from some side effects.
It is I, Sleeve of Wizard.
Oh, there you go. I was looking for you.